This series looks to officially recognise and celebrate our recently appointed professors. Today, I'm delighted that we have Professor Melissa Hamilton, who will be discussing the future of artificial intelligence in predicting crime. I'm Professor Bevin Donnelly-Lazaroff. I'm head of the School of Law in the University of Surrey, and it's been an absolute delight to get to know Melissa and her work over the last few years. There are a couple of things I need to let you know about before we begin. First, of course, we want to hear your questions at the end of this lecture. So can I encourage you to submit any questions using the Q&A box throughout the event? And we'll do our best to get through as many of them as we can in the second half of the session. Second, please just keep in mind that the event is being recorded and will be made available for viewing on demand on the dedicated series webpage, which I'd encourage you all to have a look at. So Melissa is a professor of law and criminal justice at the University of Surrey School of Law. Professor Hamilton is also a Surrey Artificial Intelligence Fellow with the Surrey Institute for People-Centered AI, and she's a fellow with the Royal Statistical Society. Melissa is a member of the American Psychological Association and an affiliate of the Association of Threat Assessment Professionals. Her research interests include empirical analyses of the use of algorithmic risk assessment tools in criminal justice, policing, sentencing, corrections, and the perpetration and victimization of violent acts. She's been at the absolute forefront of exposing the bias sometimes inherent in these tools. Professor Hamilton has numerous publications. These appear in legal and in scientific journals and books. And prior to taking up her academic post, she's had a diverse history. She worked as a police officer and a prison officer in Florida. She clerked for Judge Sam Johnson of the United States Courts of Appeal for the Fifth Circuit. And she practiced law as in-house counsel for multinational technology corporations. Professor Hamilton holds a Juris Doctorate in law and a PhD in criminology from the University of Texas at Austin. Apart from her remarkable achievements to date, that will no doubt continue to blossom, Melissa's pursuit of knowledge is accompanied by a much underrated quality, modesty. And moreover, this quiet approach to her important work is one which inspires me and I know inspires all her colleagues. So I will now hand over to Melissa. Please give a warm welcome to Professor Melissa Hamilton.
Thank you so much, Bevin. That was too kind. Okay, can you see my screen now? Yes. All right. Well, thank you everyone for joining us today. This talk in part is about marrying the old, as in crime, which has existed throughout the ages, with the new, as in artificial intelligence. In terms of artificial intelligence, there are two major initiatives, at least with respect to predictive technologies in criminal justice. There's hotspot policing, as in which areas are likely the next places for violent crime to occur. And then there's what's been nicknamed hot people, which is to identify which individuals are likely to commit a crime. Today, though, I am focused on the hot people form of AI. The idea is similar to the plot of the film Minority Report about pre-crime, which is identifying the individuals who commit a crime in the future, but acting on that knowledge now, as in to incapacitate them before they're able to commit that crime. The pre-crime model here is based on risk assessment tools developed using scientific methods. At a very high level, the idea is to select out of a criminal justice population the group that is at high risk, and then to decide, for example, to incapacitate them. Or for those at low risk, perhaps some sort of diversion may be appropriate. These days, risk assessment tools may actually follow an individual through their lifespan in the criminal justice system. It may begin with risk assessment predictions informing police as to whether to make an arrest. After arrest, risk assessment can inform pretrial decisions, whether to release the individual or to continue to detain them pending trial, and potentially even the amount of any bail to be required for their release. At sentencing, these risk assessment tools are informing judges in their decisions, whether to use a custodial sentence or otherwise to assign the individual to probation or a community order. Risk assessment may be also used in determining sentence length. Then if the person is imprisoned, the prison system may use these kind of predictions to assign a security classification, such as the minimum or maximum security. These predictions are informing early release decisions. And even at the very back end of sentencing, in terms of, for instance, determining based on the person's risk, what supervision level ought to be assigned. Or if the individual violates a term of supervision, sometimes officials are taking into consideration what their risk level is in determining whether they should revoke their supervision and return the person to prison or not. These risk tools then are acting as predictive technologies. They are based on scientific models of prediction, typically using historical samples of individuals who were released from custody, and then their recidivism outcomes tracked. Recidivism here can mean a variety of different things depending on the particular tool and the purpose it's used for. For example, it's common for a recidivism to be defined as a new arrest, or it could be some other kind of failure event, such as failing to appear for court dates, or perhaps non-compliance with some type of supervisory condition. So it may be of interest how these tools are developed. A developer wanting to create a tool then will find that historical data set. They will test factors that correlate with recidivism, and that means what factors seem to be associated with an individual committing a new criminal act or not. Then from the factors that are found to be statistically significant, the tool developer will select them, and then they will weight them accordingly because some factors are simply more highly predictive than others. The most heavily weighted factors in most of the tools then are age and criminal history because of their salience in predicting reoffending. For example, it's commonly found that a younger age is more predictive of reoffending, and then a significant criminal history is also predictive of reoffending. The developers then will finalize their predictive algorithm. Now here, an algorithm in essence means a mathematical equation. Or you might think of it as a recipe, one that, for example, calls for 2 cups flour plus 1 teaspoon vanilla, et cetera. The common risk factors then, if you start kind of in the upper middle there, is you'll see some of the criminal history events, such as past arrests, whether the person, for example, failed at a previous supervision, or other evidence of violent acts. You can see in the bottom left there is some things relative to finances, such as is the person employed full-time or not, and wages. For example, there's a particular tool that asks the individual, if you were released, do you think you'll be able to get employment that pays a living wage or not? In the middle there, you'll notice mental disorders. A number of tools include them as predictive of reoffending. And then certain personality characteristics, such as what is the person's attitude toward rehabilitation? Do they have a positive attitude or potentially a negative attitude? And that can be also a risk factor or not. You'll see a couple things relative to education, for example, whether the individual went in school was subject to school suspension, or what's the highest level of education that they achieved. In the upper right, you can see some then count things that are actually relevant to other people, but still count in terms of negatively or positively toward this individual's likelihood of reoffending, such as whether they have friends or family who are known to be criminal. And then we are back there to age being a predictive factor in many of these tools. The algorithms then can be either simple or more complex. On the left-hand side is an example of a simple one, such as, for example, the total points may be based on a formula that multiplies the age factor, say, times 2, criminal history times 3, educational level by 1.5, et cetera. On the right is a more complex form which is, for example, representing machine learning and maybe much more dynamic in nature than a static equation. To give you an example of a relatively simple one, this is a screenshot of just a portion of a risk assessment tool. The PITRA is the pretrial risk assessment tool used in the federal criminal justice system in the US. And notice that you'll see some points that are assigned to specific of the factors, which are indicative of the weights of those particular scores or factors. This is an example of a relatively simple algorithm. So then what does a jurisdiction that adopts a tool, how is it used in practice? Typically, it requires a human evaluator to gather information to score the factors the particular tool requires. For example, often they will use data from official reports, such as the person's criminal history or their educational record. Some of the tools, though, require the evaluator actually interview the individual to elicit more information, which could be, for example, what is their attitude toward rehabilitation programming, or to ask them to identify their friends for the evaluator to determine, are they friends who are also known to be criminals if the particular tool scores that factor. The evaluator then typically will input these data points into the computer system for the algorithm then to process and to output a prediction. Still, it's noted that in recent times, there have been efforts to entirely automate this process by building a computer program that then automatically corrects the information points from computer databases and have the algorithm score it, all now potentially without any human involvement. And then in the end, it's common for these risk assessment tools to use the point totals and then to combine them in a fashion that puts people into buckets such as these. Notice the ordinal nature from low to medium and high, with hopefully fewer offenders being placed in the higher risk categories. So you can see from this why these tools can be very appealing to criminal justice officials, because it allows them to categorize their populations into subgroups and then potentially to manage them accordingly. As an example, if the computer output, the risk result is high, then that may indicate to officials those are the individuals potentially they should select for incapacitation, such as imprisonment. Or if the risk result from the computer output is a low risk, maybe those are the ones that they determine can be safely released into the community. So from these big data and predictive analytics, there's a number of potential benefits, and these are some of the ones that are most salient. It could the risk assessment regime then convince judges to release more people, therefore to reduce detention rates, because it may convince criminal justice officials that a greater proportion of their population is at lower risk than they might have assumed, and thus could be safely released into the community. It may reduce reliance upon bail, also convincing judges, for example, that potentially most of the individuals have great prospects for appearing for their court dates without the need for a carrot or the stick of monetary bail. It can then more effectively use resources by focusing the resources more on those at higher risk, and also to reduce resources of those at lower risk, because there are some studies that indicate over-programming for those at lower risk may actually have negative consequences for them. And then in terms of mitigating human biases, well, these predictions of risk have been traditionally part of decision-making in criminal justice for centuries. But the traditional method had been for individual human decision-makers to make those predictions, which were often based on their intuition or their gut instinct. But both intuition and gut instinct are highly flawed. And then in terms of accountability, the risk assessment regime might provide some better consistency, transparency, and then potentially a way to track this part of the decision-making process. I'm now going to switch gears and come to a however. The however for that is that we are unfortunately finding evidence of some unfairness in these risk tool schemes, such as unfairness based on demographic characteristics, including race, ethnicity, and gender. In terms of then accounting for that is to correct for this demographic unfairness, what we're finding is that it's often at the expense of accuracy. And then defining accuracy as the percent of correct predictions. So criminal justice officials are facing some very difficult trade-offs where to improve fairness from a demographic perspective, it might be at the cost of accuracy and vice versa. By increasing accuracy might be at the expense of fairness. And to date, what I've seen so far is that officials have been preferring more accurate measures than they have in preferring demographic fairness. And so the weight of the balance scale I have on this particular slide is trying to indicate that accuracy is preferred. Although now I look at it as maybe then accuracy should have been weightier. So I might have picked the wrong direction for that. But in any event, what I mean by accuracy in terms of the percentage of correct predictions is if the prediction is high risk and the person is a recidivist, then that's considered an accurate prediction. Likewise, if a low risk person or low risk predicted person does not recidivate, then that's actually also considered an accurate prediction. But the other two cells are the inaccuracy. Those are the errors. So when the particular tool predicts a person to be at high risk and they don't recidivate, then that's an error, which we call a false positive. And then a low risk prediction where the person actually does recidivate, that's also an error, which we call a false negative. But what about demographic unfairness? What if even a tool that is highly predictive overall, I mean, highly accurate overall, what if it systematically rates minorities at higher risk than white? Is that defined or does that indicate demographic inequality? Well, this inequality then in terms of demographic unfairness may actually be due to biases in the algorithm. Biases unfortunately may lead then to the tool to overpredict or underpredict either an individual or a group's risk level, such as in the visual here of overshooting or undershooting the target being a correct prediction. So there's a reason that the tools may be unfair. Because of the real potential that the algorithms are embedded with biases. And biases can then be embedded in the process in a variety of ways. If we start out with the training sample, what we commonly find is the risk assessment tools were developed on samples that were mostly white males. That will mean then that the algorithm will learn the risk relevant factors for white males. Which might not then be as accurate for others. For example, studies indicate that there are risk-relevant differences based on such attributes as race, gender, and age. And then the training data. Biases may be embedded through decisions by other actors in the system. For example, to the extent that these tools often use criminal history, well, the criminal history may be biased with police decisions to arrest that are discretionary in nature and therefore may be discriminatory. And the algorithm may learn that, may embed those biased police decisions. Or if the tool includes factors relating to education, then maybe biased decisions based on educational officials that may inhibit the level of education the individual was allowed to achieve may embed those biases into the system. Or as another example, to the extent that the particular tool includes factors related to employment, it may learn on systematic biases in which there were barriers placed to minorities being able to get to attain favorable job prospects. There may actually be some biases in certain decisions by humans, the developers, in selecting which factors to include in their tool. Because even though a variety of factors may be found to be statistically significant in terms of predicting recidivism, sometimes the tool developers decide not to include those factors in their final algorithm. And that could be for more benign reasons, such as perhaps the decision was because they thought that there wasn't going to be available data to score that particular factor across individuals. But we've also found when digging, for instance, is that sometimes the tool developers are making decisions for political reasons to exclude certain factors or to try to include a factor they may not be overly significant, but they might find that there is political will to have the factor included. And then there's the relevance of decision on, do you include or do you have one algorithm, as if there's one size fits all? What we're finding in some of the studies, for example, if there's one algorithm used to conduct predictions for both males and females, is it's common then for the tool to actually over-predict for females. And the reason for that is that pretty consistently is the recidivism rates for females tends to be much lower than males. And so one algorithm generally will disserve females in terms of over-predicting for them. And see, these are various ways that the outcome, the prediction of high risk or low risk, for example, may be just embedded with biases. So what started as my little biased egg over these processes then can end up being a bigger biased egg. Let me give you some examples of this from a couple of studies that I did of very popular risk assessment tools. This first visual is of a popular tool that the outcomes ranged from 1 to 10, where the higher number, it was related to a higher risk of recidivism predicted. And the particular tool then would predict a higher risk level as the prediction outcome rose steadily from 1 to 10. What I was particularly interested in here is to study the contrast between how well the tool predicted for Hispanics in the sample versus non-Hispanics. And the reason to use that particular ethnicity is the sample was a US sample where Hispanics is generally considered a subgroup of the population. In any event, what you'll find there is the solid line is the predicted line for the entire population. And again, you can see then it's linear increasing the predictions when the risk assessment number, the scale rate rises from 1 to 10. The orange line, dotted line then, is for the whites, non-Hispanics, which are basically whites in this population. And you can see that the actual observed rate, which is the actual rates in reality of the non-Hispanics, i.e. the whites, pretty closely tracks the predicted line, meaning that the tool does really well in terms of predicting for non-Hispanics. The blue dotted line, though, is the Hispanic observed rate of recidivism, and you're seeing it go all over the place, which means the tool is really poor at predicting the recidivism rates for the Hispanic population. And in fact, the tool sometimes overpredicts for Hispanics and other times underpredicts, and it's just wildly erratic. So it's kind of indicative of that the tool just really did not learn very well on what the risk relevant factors for Hispanics were. And so what you can see there is then the evidence of the bias. To the extent the blue line is away from the predicted line, that's indicative of bias. And then in another study, I was focused on gender. So in this study, what I did instead was to isolate to those individuals that the tool predicted were high risk. And then I looked at by gender is what was the recidivism rate for those in the high risk group that were males versus females. And you'll notice this extreme disparity there where of the males in the high risk group, 52% of them had recidivated. However, of the females who were in that high risk group, only 25% recidivated. And that's a great gap between in the high risk group, the percentage that recidivated that were female versus male, indicating then that the tool was substantially over predicting for females, therefore indicating gender bias, and then which I relabeled as indicative of a sexist algorithm. So what can be done? These are just some ideas to throw out there for you to consider. Is one is to make greater efforts to ensure that the training sample is representative of the population the tool is going to be used on in practice. As an example, if the training sample is entirely of adults, then the tool is going to be inappropriate if it's going to be used in practice on juveniles, because there are risk-relevant differences between adults and juveniles. Or if the training sample is substantially white males, then it's going to be probably poor predicting, for example, for females or for Hispanics or for other minorities. Another possibility is to oversample for minority groups. to be sure that the algorithm is better learning on these other groups, what are the more risk relevant factors for them. There could be efforts to clean the input data. And there's been recent discussions about how to do that, although none of these solutions are going to be fully palatable for everybody, because again, there are sometimes trade-offs. As an example, there is a suggestion put out there is if the biases are in the criminal history data, biases based on minority status, is maybe then a possibility is to reweight the criminal history based on the person's race or ethnicity. And you can imagine why that might not be fully palatable to others whose argument is then that is them itself biased. If you're going to have a criminal history score based on the same criminal history, but it's going to count differently based on the person's race or ethnicity, then that's the counter argument. So again, there are very difficult arguments and trade-offs to be made here, but at least there can be some considerations of things such as that. I would also call for more transparency with the human decisions that are made in the process. For example, when the developers decide what factors to include in the model or not, the factors that in their study were statistically significant, but they removed them, maybe that should be subject to public debate as to why they made that decision, as well as more public debate about analyzing the potential effects of these decisions on both the accuracy and fairness of the risk assessment tool as a result. Another reason then to hold these things up to public scrutiny is to engage in public debate about other types of legal or ethical challenges that result from it, the decision. And then I also like to call for third-party audits, which is developers, even though they're scientists, they're still human. And when they create their risk assessment tool, they would like to believe as scientists, they remain objective. However, it's still the tool ends up being their baby. And as humans, we want our babies to shine. And so I believe that the developers kind of have blinders on to some extent about not realizing what biases and other flaws may be in that tool. Whereas third parties who aren't so embedded in wanting the tool to look as a shiny new model, maybe more willing to uncover those biases. And it's important because these tools are informing important decisions in which people's lives matter. Whether, for example, somebody is sentenced to a prison sentence is highly significant to that individual. So when these tools are used in a criminal justice context, I think that it is required almost of criminal justice officials then to be more transparent and to call in third parties to conduct these audits so that more knowledge is shared about how these tools are operating in practice. So just some things to think about. And then, so thank you very much. And I'll end it now and throw it back to Bevan to
thank you very much, Melissa, for that absolutely fascinating insight into your research. Can I remind members of the audience, please, to use the Q&A function at the bottom of the Zoom screen to ask any questions. Melissa, I really loved that last observation that it's just true that we want our children to do well, and therefore that we tend to overlook flaws. And that's absolutely the case, except when it comes to my children who are completely perfect, of course. I wouldn't fall foul of that reasoning.
And Phoebe's perfect as well.
And okay. Phoebe's perfect, yeah.
Famously.
And Ira's children, all of them. So I think I'm going to abuse moderator privilege maybe and kick off the discussion. So Melissa, you mentioned a number of biases that might be built into these prediction tools. So there are some ethical issues you drew to the fore. I wonder, however, is there something more fundamental at stake here? So when these tools are used, is it the case that they effectively treat people as categories, that they're assessing people according to a checklist, which it seems at least potentially fundamentally wrong, because that's not what people are like. By nature, people are individuals. And so these tools are, I suppose we might say, dehumanizing individuals. They're reducing people to something that people aren't. That is a category. Is that a fair criticism?
It is, because it's, again, relating to the film Minority Report, it's as if we are predicting human behavior, as if discounting that individuals have free will, which is interesting because that undermines a principle of criminal law, which is we assume free will. But these risk assessment tools almost do not. And they indicate, they are taking a person and drilling them down to factors rather than indicating that a person, for example, can decide to rehabilitate themselves. It almost assumes that you're bound to commit a crime if you have a high risk score. And yes, it is trading the person's individuality with a label. You are now, the criminal justice sees the individual as a number in terms of a risk score, or as a category, such as a risk bin. You fall into the high risk bin instead of you're a human that can evolve and can better yourself. It also then is relating the person to not only their future, but they are now comprised of their past. And we all make mistakes in our past and we'd like to move on from that. But the risk assessment tools basically don't allow people some cases to move on. And some of these tools for criminal history, for example, is they'll count criminal history when the person was a juvenile. And that criminal history then may follow them, can mark them in terms of the risk into their 60s, 70s, 80s, basically for the rest of their lives. And so, yes, it's dehumanizing in terms of you are now replaced as an individual. Your name is now obscured. You are now indicating you're a number. On that scale of the 1 to 10, you're an 8, for example, or you are medium risk instead of an individual.
Thanks, Melissa. That's a really nice reply. I've got a question here from the audience from David Lloyd. So David congratulates you on a nice talk and an interesting talk. He says that the predictive algorithms you present involve predicting an individual's outcome or risk of reoffending. And David's wondering, do people try to predict or analyze metapopulation outcomes and understand how various policies affect metapopulations?
So thank you, David, for the nice comments. I appreciate it. And very good point. I conceptualized it probably what would be incorrect is that these are actually not individual predictions, but I probably conveyed it in that manner, being too simplistic. These are actually group predictions. So it's a really good insight that you had on that. Is in reality, these, because it's based on big data and group past groups, is it really is putting a prediction on the group rather than the individual. The individual is part of that group. Say, for example, the high risk group is associated with, just to be simple, a 50% chance of reoffending. The tool can't say which individuals in that group that is in that high risk bucket will reoffend. The tool can simply say 50% of these will reoffend. And so to that extent, another criticism is it's not in the end an individual prediction. It's based on group statistics. And that's another observation of potentially an unethical aspect of this, is it's also de-individualizing, dehumanizing the person, because it's now you are labeled with the risk level of the group rather than yours individually. So for example, there could be something idiosyncratic about the individual within that group that makes them really at lower risk of recidivism. Say for example, based on their prior factors, say they've got a significant criminal history, which again is going to really drive up their score. But say, for instance, they have suffered a health crisis where they're basically incapacitated by the health issue and therefore unlikely to reoffend. The risk tool would not consider that whatsoever, and they'd still be labeled as a high risk in that particular example. But good insight, good question.
Thanks, Melissa. So we have another question here from the floor from an anonymous attendee. So this person notes that the tools are used for decision-making. So how much do these prediction tools actually affect the human decision? How much, for example, do the police in the UK rely on prediction tools in their role?
Very good question. It varies dramatically by the jurisdiction as well as the decision point about how weighty these particular risk assessment predictions go into the decision. So it can be anywhere from purely discretionary to some systems actually built it into the decision-making model. So for example, the mention of police in the UK in terms of decisions to arrest, the way that the risk assessment tool most commonly is used is relevant to domestic violence calls. So there's a specific tool that police agencies in England use, a risk prediction tool that is specific to predicting an individual engaging in a severe domestic violence action in the future. So it's informing their decision, and some police in some jurisdictions think it's a really weighty reason to make an arrest or not if there's that particular tool indicates a high risk, but they're not mandated to make a risk even in that. But let me give you an example of a jurisdiction that basically uses a mandatory risk tool, and that's a sentencing jurisdiction in the US, more specifically Virginia. Their sentencing system indicates, and again, they're using a specified risk assessment that is predicting sexual recidivism, and it's designed for those who have been convicted of a sexual crime. And the way that the sentencing guideline in that particular jurisdiction uses it is if the individual with this tool is put in the high risk of sexual recidivism category, the recommended sentence actually changes, it's actually increased. So that's an example of a model where it's kind of mandatory, although it's a little bit weak and mandatory because it doesn't end up saying to the judge, you have to give them a higher sentence, but it is a strong consideration. It moves up the risk assessment recommendation based on the risk assessment tool. And then other jurisdictions rely more heavily on these risk assessment tools. But again, it depends on the decision point. So because some decisions, we want there to be more human involvement, and other decisions that are not as intrusive on the individual, we are, as a system, willing to have more or less discretion. For example, the decision to arrest is not as weighty as a decision to sentence somebody to a long prison term.
Great. Thank you, Melissa. We have a question from the room here. Marie Newhouse is a colleague of Melissa's in the School of Law.
Hi, Melissa. Thanks so much for this really interesting talk. I was wondering, I think the unfairness of these algorithms is most troubling to us when there are decisions made on that basis that determine whether the person is free or not. So I'm thinking about parole decisions, for example, and pretrial detention decisions and sentencing decisions. And I had two questions about that. First was, can you tell us something at a very general level about the legal status of legal challenges to the constitutionality perhaps of these in the United States? And then my other question was, it seems like these algorithms would be far less troubling if they were used to target interventions which were not so harmful or didn't involve the deprivation of liberty. And I was wondering if you could let us know whether there were interventions, paying more attention to people perhaps who are high risk in some positive way, that we'd be more comfortable with using the algorithms for.
Very good question. So in terms of legal challenges, we're just at the beginning of lawyers challenging these in court, we being across Western countries. So it's a very exciting time for lawyers to get into this practice because the arguments are still to be made. It's at the beginning of developing the legal paradigm for these risk assessment tools. But there are such challenges such as what's called due process. Due process, for example, some challenges that I can foresee are, what rights do these individuals have to have access to the risk score that was assigned to them? What rights do they have, for example, to challenge what the data was used to score that individual? Can they suggest that there were errors made in scoring? And then probably more difficult is, what rights do they have to these underlying algorithms? Because while some of these algorithms are public, if they are, for example, developed by a public agency, but some of these are private in nature, they're proprietary, that the owners of them are private companies and they declare trade secrets and refuse to release the algorithm. So the balancing there though is, okay, the company may technically have trade secret rights, but then the individual in the criminal justice system where that algorithm may be sending them to prison, don't they have a greater right, is the argument, to that underlying algorithm to make those challenges? Because if it's a human decision, when it is a weighty outcome such as imprisonment, generally the individual has a right to challenge the human decision-making aspect. For example, to challenge the judge's discretion about giving them a custodial sentence. It's harder sometimes to challenge an algorithm, but isn't there potentially a right to? Now, some courts have disagreed. This has risen, for example, to the highest court in Canada, which and a couple of courts in the US, which have determined that no, the trade secret rights of the companies override that due process right. But I don't think that's the end of the argument. Another challenge can be equal protection, to the extent that, for example, the tools are predicting a higher rate of minorities in the higher risk categories, for instance. I can see equal protection being argued there. But also due process on the basis of differences in race, ethnicity is, shouldn't they have a right to the underlying data and to challenge, for example, the biases that are getting into that data? And your other question was on intervention. There is another aspect of the risk regime that I didn't discuss today, and that's called the risk/needs analysis. The needs aspect is a part of, and some conceptualize it as an addition to risk, but there are some experts who believe that needs assessment ought to be separate than the risk. But in any event, the needs part of it is what you were referring to, which is identifying the individual needs that the person has, such as the needs that are related to their recidivism risk. A need is, for example, say the risk factor of educational level. So there the tools will generally say a lower educational level achieved is related to a higher risk of recidivism. Well, that means there's a need there. There's a need for the person that didn't, for example, get a college education. If they did get a college education, their risk level would decrease. So the need would then be identify education as a need and therefore assign programming relevant to that need, which would probably be educational. So it is a part of the paradigm. Not as many jurisdictions are using the needs aspect. In fact, only a small subset are compared to how many are using risk assessment. And they are using the needs aspect much less in terms of, it's a weaker aspect of their system, but we have high hopes for the needs aspect to be embedded in more of the systems. Perspective is, well, okay, so you've identified people at high risk, but shouldn't you as a system be doing something about it, such as giving them opportunities to reduce their high risk level? And that would be go a little bit toward individualizing the person again.
Thank you.
Thanks, Melissa. I have another question, if I may, which maybe pushes back a little against one of your claims. At least I think it's a claim you make, not just your interlocutors. So you mentioned the way in which potentially these prediction tools can defeat some of the problems of human frailty in decision making. And indeed, this is something that neuroscientists claim as well when it comes to predicting crime, that their skills provide a better, more reliable tool for prediction than judges do or than probation officers do. And you note in your talk, and this is the point I take issue with, that those actors tend to rely on instinct or intuition, gut instinct. But I wonder what a really experienced judge or a really experienced probation officer is relying on is not so much intuition or instinct, but an intimate familiarity with defendants, with human beings, with human nature, and a familiarity that's born from long experience of challenging questions in courtrooms, of really dissecting the evidence and in those ways, becoming really, really closely familiar with what human beings are like. And isn't that how we really know people, how we really understand people? By seeing them in action, by talking to them, by seeing how they respond to questions, by listening to them. Don't these tools miss all of that? So yes, there's a frailty in human decision-making, but there's also an awful lot to be said for it that these tools, and neuroscience in fact as well, misses completely.
Yeah, so certainly judges, police officers, experienced parole officers will absolutely declare, I know it when I see it, and very heavily believe that. So there's a couple, many responses to that one. In some cases, these tools build in what's called overrides, the ability to override the prediction based on the professional abilities and for example, the probation officer or the judge. So that is built into the system for many of these tools. However, on the studies that are available pretty consistently when they study what happens when there are those overrides is that those are often less accurate than the tool. So in other words, the evidence of that doesn't suggest that those human instincts, although it's really, as you said, not instinct, it's their professional experience, tends not to be correct. But the other problem there, I guess, is that when the people say, I know it when I see it, isn't that a source for bias? Because they might, for example, if the judge who is in pretrial is mostly seeing the arrestees of dark color, aren't they going to then unconsciously embed in their system is dark color is associated with being arrested for a crime? And so the unfortunate thing is that it allows for those unconscious biases based on what they're observing. So on the outside, which is skin color, which is gender often, and other things that then can be a source of bias, unfortunately.
But isn't it the case that judicial processes, the courtroom, probation techniques, precisely the thing they allow is that we go beneath the surface, where those processes enable us to make decisions that aren't reliant on appearances or checklists and categories of the sort that prediction tools rely on?
Depends on the decision point. For example, if you're talking sentencing, yes, to the extent that the commonality in Western jurisdictions is to have a pre-sentence report in which somebody has dug into the person's background, or parole where they have tracked the person and they know a lot about them while the person was in prison. But think about the police decision to arrest on the street where they have no background about the individual. They're only seeing what the person in front of them, or the judge at pretrial where they're running pretrial is we have studies indicate, for example, on average, the judge may look at the person for 20 seconds and make a decision. And so in those cases, they don't have almost no background of the individual. Mostly the information is what was the person arrested for and what do they look like?
Yeah, Marie's got another question here.
This one is on a small point, but you said something that intrigued me early on in your presentation. You said there were studies that showed that what you called over-programming could actually be counterproductive when targeted at people who are not at elevated risk. And I was sort of fascinated about that because I tend to, you know, really think there are a lot of wonderful charitable efforts out there that are going into schools and convincing kids to, you know, stay off drugs and stay away from organized crime and things like that. Could they be doing more harm than good? What is this evidence?
Okay, good question. So the evidence is that, so think about anybody who is assigned programming. You have to show up here and these days, and you have to take time away, even if it's while you're working or otherwise you're getting an education, and you have to show up for these things. It's setting them up for failure by requiring them to do all these things. And so the failure then is what's the negative consequence? If, for example, they're released pretrial and they're told any person actually is, you have to show up for drug programming and you have to show up regularly with your probation officer to check in. Well, there's reasons that law-abiding people can't do that because maybe they'll then lose their job. Maybe they don't have childcare. Maybe their car wasn't working. They don't have transportation. And so it's setting them up for failure simply by not being able to appear, even if it's a very innocent reason that they don't show up. But the other reason is, regardless of that, say that you have an individual who does, who is able to show up for all those things, is what's called social learning theory. You're putting them in places with other people who likely have committed crimes, and there might be learning their bad habits. Whereas if you didn't have them, didn't require them to associate with those individuals, they wouldn't have, they might not otherwise have been allowed access to those antisocial beliefs, as well as skills about, for example, here's how to commit crime, but here to commit it in a better way so that you don't get caught. So those are some of the reasons that the low risk people, we set them up to fail if they are over programmed.
Thank you, Melissa. Can I just check if there are any other questions from the floor? Please, again, use the Q&A function at the bottom of the Zoom screen. Okay, well, maybe a final question from me then, Melissa. So you've done a lot of work on this, and you know the insights you have gleaned are very, very illuminating indeed. What's next, essentially? That's a big question.
Yes. So the next is more wrangling about what to do about balancing the demographic fairness and the accuracy. For example, a risk assessment tool that was just rolled out in the last couple of years in the Federal Bureau of Prisons in the U.S., we found out that over 50% of the Black individuals were assigned to the high-risk category. So it keeps coming that the potential for unfairness based on demographics is going to continue unless something is done. So the debates will be about how do you then correct for that, but then you don't substantially reduce the accuracy. We're going to see in the future more that the machine learning algorithms. We're also going to see removing individuals from the evaluation of the fully automating the tools. And that will reduce then the ability to do the professional overrides as a result. What I hope to see is more studies that do look at risk factors for minority populations, that there's more awareness that the risk factors are not common to all. Some will be. So for example, the age and criminal history may be pretty common across race and ethnicities as well as gender. But there are other things. For example, the things that are more risk relevant for females than males are having a history of trauma, particularly related to being a victim of domestic abuse or sexual assault abuse. And that's also related to the needs aspect that Maria was referring to is for those women, for example, is the reason that they might have been involved in criminal activity is because of their traumatic past, then they have a need, which is resources to deal with that traumatic past. Could be counseling, for instance. It could be medication for post-traumatic stress disorder. And what I am really hoping, although this is selfish on my part from a professional perspective, is to allow and to see more legal and ethical arguments to increase the transparency of these tools so that defendants potentially can challenge these instruments and tools, as well as I hope for more education of criminal justice officials so that even if they decide to use these tools, they're more aware of the flaws of them, as well as more aware of what are best practices that they may not be following. So that as an academic, I don't think it's my place to tell any jurisdiction you ought to or ought not to use a risk assessment tool. I think that that's up to the decision makers, that it's their responsibility, the policy makers, that it's their job to make those tough decisions. But I would want them to be more aware of knowledge about how these tools were created, what their flaws are, improve best practices. And I hope to be, have been a part of that to some extent, and hope they will allow academics and others with knowledge of that to engage with them, and for this to be really an interdisciplinary effort, that criminal justice officials, they're not on the, not left on their own on this.
That sounds like the kind of work that could really have a significant impact and an important impact on the criminal justice system. And it's particularly difficult, I suppose, for academics to reach out into the world like that. Your work has already had considerable impact. Do you want to maybe say something about that to those listening, the way in which you've reached audiences outside academia?
Sometimes it's a long road coming. So if you're interested in doing that, again, there's plenty of space for it to be done in. It's just finding the opportunities for stakeholders to be willing to engage. It's doing a lot of networking. And then at some point, so a lot of the networking ends up being a waste of time in retrospect, but sometimes you never know. Years of working on something and suddenly you get contacted by a high level official who, for example, says, can you come testify before Congress on this? And so there are those sometimes that can come up, but it sometimes will take years of trying to get in with the right people. But that's part of the process in academia because stakeholders, they're busy as well. And maybe they have other things. And so it's just working on continuing to work. The other thing I would mention too is trying to place articles in more public oriented venues and talking about it in relatable ways. So kind of stepping out of the academic speech and to say it in terms that speak to the criminal justice officials and as well as the public. I think there's public engagement here as well.
That's great, Melissa. Sadly, that's all we have time for. Thank you, Professor Hamilton, for your time and congratulations on your new appointment. Thank you in particular for the thoughtful answers to questions, which were as illuminating as the talk itself. We're all excited to hear more about your research in the future and to learn about the impact it continues to have at a very, very high level indeed. Today was the first lecture in the series, and we hope you'll join us for future Surrey inaugurals. The next lecture takes place online on Wednesday, the 6th of April. There you'll find Professor Christine Rivers, who will deliver her inaugural lecture on When, If Not Now, Mindfulness Education for Staff and Students. For our full programme, please visit our webpage. The link is in the chat function here. Once again, thank you, Melissa, and thank you all for joining us. Bye.
Thank you all in the office.
Bye.
Bye-bye.